G'day guys and girls, and welcome back to another edition of Damo's Team Talk. This one coming out of the first bye week, which was of course round 12. I think I fared pretty well, just in terms of trades, of course, which I'll delve into during this discussion. And all things score, planning, buy-wise. I'm ahead of projections, which I'll obviously get into as well. Just planning, obviously. The end game coming out of buys is, of course, to, I guess, improve upon my ranking as it was heading into the buy period. And also, of course, trying to, I guess, upgrade my team to its full potential with a full set of primos and mainly being able to afford to bring back in the pink sweaty pig himself in Clary Oliver. So everything's going to plan so far. So let's delve into how I went on the weekend. Of course, before I kick things off, and I'll jump back across. Sorry, I've jumped ahead of myself. Before I kick things off, of course, if you enjoy all of our content, that being, of course, the Team Talk episodes like this, our weekly vodcast and podcasts, depending on how you like to consume the content, whether it be visual or, I guess, just audio-wise, if you don't like seeing our faces and the stupid, insane memes and visual gags that we whack up on screen during the vodcast. If you like all of that, feel free, of course, to like the videos here and give us a nice little subscribe. Liam and I were trying to get to the, we say this every single week, I guess, we're trying to catapult ourselves towards the 1K subscriber mark. So if you can help us along our way, we'd be very much appreciative of that. So without further ado, let's jump into how I went this week. So there we have it. You can see there, I ended up scoring a 1,906 for the week. And in terms of ranking-wise, I actually ended up going up 140 spots to now sit overall 1,573. So I guess I'm going in the right direction. Was hoping to jump up a little bit more, but as I said from the top, outside of coming out of the bye weeks, I am looking to be in a better rank than what I was heading into the bye weeks. And I guess more specifically, I'm looking to crack the top 1K in rank coming out of the bye. So I guess I'm on track, extrapolating that 140 rank spot difference for this week. So hopefully that continues. So let's jump into my team, which is a little bit of a sneak peek I gave you before, to show you how things shaped up. Now, this is, of course, changed coming out of the bye week. So I will switch back to the way things looked, and I'm kind of giving away what my trade is going to be this week. So let's just switch things back to the way they were. And that's how it looked last week. So I'll kick things off by letting you know what trades I ended up doing. And you'll see here on the right-hand side, hopefully you can see that here, I ended up trading, and you would have seen it, of course, in last week's Team Talk episode, I traded Darcy to Tim English, who we spoke about also in the weekly podcast last week, who was absolutely extreme value. I think he was priced the fourth most expensive ruckman, despite the fact that he's the highest averaging and the highest scoring ruckman thus far in 2023. So crazy value, and I couldn't pass that up. So ended up trading Darcy to English, and I'll delve into shortly as to why that was such a good trade. Ended up cashing in, I guess, Samson Ryan for Ford. Nice little cash grab there, and obviously Ford being the most in-demand cash cow with the, I think it was -114, I think, from memory, break even. So a lot of people jumped on him, and for good reason. And then I ended up cashing in Sam Simpson-y for Briggs, who we're now going to dub the Briglet, the absolute piglet himself, in Kieran Briggs. Because we spoke about him again on the weekly podcast, Liam and I, and because he's a cash cow, and you had to have jumped on him, and for good reason, because he actually, I'll start off with him in terms of talking about my team overall, and ended up punching out that 128, which was more than what we were hoping for, really. I was hoping for around about 100, that would have been nice, but to see him punch out the 128 was absolutely insane. And I was working all day yesterday, which was Sunday the 4th, doing a little bit of filming, which you'll see some of my work come out there for the Melbourne Renegades for their upcoming Renegades Recruit TV series. So look out for that. But I was tied up yesterday with that and wasn't able to see any of the games really, but ended up seeing the scoreline and saw that he had actually punched out that score. And I was like, wow, that was incredible. So nice to see that. And it does mean that he went up, 86K in a single week, which is crazy, crazy stuff. And it means also that his break even heading into this coming round is a negative 32 and projected to make another 55.4K. So I think by the end of it, my plans still are as they were. In terms of getting him in, I was always planning to get rid of him on his buy, which is round 15. And he will have made, hopefully by that stage, close to around about 180K, pushing up towards that 200K mark, which is more than what I was hoping for and dreaming of. So he is virtually my ticket to getting Clary, the pink sweaty pig, back into my team. So nice score, 128, was super handy. Obviously having Marshall on the bye. And the other guy alongside him was the other absolute legend that I brought in to my team, as I mentioned, in Timmy English, 156, which ended up being, what was it? Was it his highest for the season? I think it was, yeah. 156 was his highest score for the year. And now I can finally say that I know what it feels like to be an English owner when he punches out one of those crazy, crazy scores. So that was nice to see first up from him. As I mentioned, he was extreme value and I couldn't pass that up. And it was just perfect timing, I think, with Darcy going down with injury. We spoke about on the podcast last week. You could have potentially opted to wait for him, but I think I kind of flew in the face of what the historical average was against the Cats. So yeah, I flew the flag with that, brought him in and he punched out that nice score there and has already gone up beyond the 600K mark. Tune into our podcast for this week because we will be discussing him. Still, he presents as a little bit of value compared to, I guess, what he should be priced at, his true price compared to his actual average. So yeah, look out for that. And then, of course, Eddie Ford, the other inclusion. He now goes into this week with a negative 17 break even, went up 72.5K, which is nice to see. And I also am looking to move him on his round 15 buy. So hopefully he can punch out a bit of a bigger score than what they've projected for him there on SuperCoach Plus, and make us a bit more coin. But I mean, nonetheless, he's going to make us a minimum of 100K, which is going to be super, super handy in terms of my remaining couple of upgrades for my team. So let's delve into the rest of the team just quickly. Sicily, of course, was rubbed out for that, I guess, high bump on, what's his name? The dude from St. Kilda, mid-season draftee. So that he was a bit of a sore miss there, but I was very lucky because I was actually going into the week with 19 players, but with Seamus Mitchell being out of the side, it meant that it went from 19 down to 18. So I was pretty lucky there. Was able to field a full side for the bye week as it is best 18. What else was there? So Tom Stewart, he scored a 127, which was always nice. Nicky Dacos, he was my vice captain, scored that 123. 120 is normally my cutoff minimum. 125 is a lock and load. So he actually ended the match with a 125 and then we scaled down to a 123 and I was like, whatever, much of a muchness, 2 points, I'll lock him in. My other captaincy backup options were Bont, Laird and Zeret, who of course Zeret was kind of my higher preference because he was facing North, which meant that I missed out on 14 points in terms of locking in Dacos over Merritt. So yeah, is what it is, but he ended up scoring 10 points more than Bont and 11 points more than Laird, my other captaincy options there. Jordan Dawson, 106, not too bad. Jay-Z, who we'll, of course, talk about more in the weekly podcast with a 59. Couple of big turnovers out in the fulls for him in quarter four against the Dons, which is really uncharacteristic for him. I know some people have spoken about him being a bit of a, you know, danger signs because his past few weeks he has been down on form. But I think it really comes down to, like, you know, he scored below 100 in his past three, but it does come down to whether or not you have the trades to afford him as a bit of a luxury sideways or upgrade. For me at the moment, as you can see, I'm down to 9 trades. And I've got a couple of rookies to upgrade after I upgrade this week, which, spoiler alert, as you would have seen just before, Lachie Neale is the upgrade that I'm bringing in this week heading into round 13. But yeah, it's going to mean that I'm down to 7 trades after this week. So actually, sorry, 8 trades after this week, because it's going to be a straight swap with that cash in the bank. So yeah, if you've got the trades to afford it, potentially, but for me, I'm just going to stick fat for the time being and maybe consider him as a luxury upgrade, later in the season. So I'll back him in. Hopefully he can arrest that, that downturn in form. Aside from him, we had Josh Whittle, had a very, very slow start to the game, ended up punching out a 90, which was great to see. And he's actually, again, making us more cash than what I expected. With a break even 38 going into this week, made 46.6K, and overall he's made us 195K. Absolutely insane. So a pleasure to have this bloke in my side, as a lot of you watching will have also. Jack Sinclair was on the bye, Will Mott, of course, as well. Will Bont, 113, not too bad. Zeret, very nice to see, 137. Timmy Taranto, 111, actually scored better in AFL Fantasy. Again, the low disposal efficiency really does let him down in SuperCoach. Rory Laird, 112, didn't tackle as much as what we were hoping for, especially off the back of that, what was it, 16 the week prior. I wonder if he's a little bit gun-shy off the back of being cited for one of those tackles against Brisbane, but only had 22 disposals as well. Yeah, so wasn't the best, but, I mean, considering it was a 22-disposal game, could have been worse, so not too bad considering that. Tom Green, 89, meh, is what it is. It's kind of par for the course for him at different stages, I think, as you can see there across the course of the year. Sammy Walsh, a bit of a down game there. I mean, to be expected, when you're playing alongside other plotters in the Carlton lineup, being a Carlton fan myself, as you all know, it's going to bring down your quality. So, yeah, it is what it is with poor Walshy. I still think he is a top, sort of 8 to 10 finishing midfielder. So, it means that those of you who don't have him, there's an opportunity there to get him in a bit of a cut price option there. Dropped 31.5K on the weekend and has a break even of 144. So you could potentially get him as low as 500K over the next couple of weeks, which will be a really, really good price to look at him at coming out of the bye that he has in round 15, and then you'll face the Hawks. So for those of you looking at a primo option, I'd be in your shoes. I'd be looking at him very, very closely, and I'm very, very jealous to get him at that price if you can. Chincotta, 61, Constable, it is what it is. There was rumors that he was going to make his way back into the side on the weekend. Wasn't to be, but yeah, that is what it is. Outside of that, as I said, English played very, very well first up. Likewise, the Briglet. Goulden had the bye, who ended up working as my loophole option in order to lock in Dakes's 123 as my vice captain. Rosie, 98. Cogs, 81. Really annoying with Cogs, but again, par for the course with him. He's just having those games where he scores around about 80-odd, and that's pretty much his floor, I think, at this stage. As frustrating as it is, but a lot of people own him, so is what it is. Offsets that risk. Sheasel, we'll speak about in the podcast also. Some people have sounded him out as questioning as whether or not he is, you know, can he be a keeper from here on out? I think he still can be. He's probably more concerning for me compared to Zeebel. At least Zeebel's keeping his spot in defense, whereas she's nuts, has been thrown around the field with Rats as the caretaker coach with Clarko out. It does mean that there's going to be some variability in your scoring, as you can see there on the right-hand side. But I'm backing him in for the time being, and I think I have to with my minimal trades, and it will present more so as a luxury upgrade or sideways trade later in the season. Mitchell, as I said, he missed through illness, and Eddie Ford, a 48, but I mean, it's a bye week. So best 18 would have been nice to have Mitchell play. And I'm backing in that he would have scored a little bit better than a 48, and that 48 would have dropped out of my best scoring 18. Okay, so let's delve into round 13 now. Turn our attention to that. Let's just quickly go optimize. Yep, that's fine. And alrighty, so of course, round 13 now, Geelong and Gold Coast are the only two teams with the bye this week. So it virtually means that we've got a full week, and it's not really classified as a bye considering that. As you can see here, I'm only missing Constable and Stewart. Constable I'm going to be missing for the rest of the year, I reckon. But Stewart's obviously the main one that I'm going to be missing. And that's about it. So the main move that I'm going to be doing, I'll fix up my captaincy and VC a little bit later when I talk about the best VC and C options. But first and foremost, in terms of moves and trade moves this week, as I mentioned earlier, got 292K in the bank. And I always planned to trade Wilmot to his teammate in Lockie Neal. So let me just do this by average. And there he is. He's the top, he's the 13th best averaging midfielder at the moment, Lockie Neal. And he presents as really good value. He's 98.7K below his starting price. So screams value there. Leaves me with 23K in the bank, but no worries there because I have the guys like Weddle, Mitchell, Ford, and Briggs, the Briglet, making me bulk cash over the buy period. So that's always been the plan. And what it does mean now is, so Neil's in the side, and it means that I've got, where are we? So with Stewart, I'll just pop him in there for the time being, but at full strength, it means that I've got one, two rookies left in my side to upgrade across the buys. And hopefully, I mean, I'm at this stage, I'm not planning to have the full complement of 22 primos or keepers coming out of the buys, but I am planning to bring Clary back into my side, which will mean shifting Dunks back into the forward line, and the pink sweaty pig will come into the midfield. So it'll mean that I've got one rookie left to go, left to upgrade coming out of the buys. So that's virtually how I stand at the moment. The one thing with Neil that I really love, which we'll again talk about in greater detail in our weekly podcast, but the fact with him and why I prefer him over the likes of, say, a Brayshaw or a Sarong, but probably more so Brayshaw that this applies to, is in comparison, Neil has a very high floor. As you can see here, he's only scored below 100 three times, and that, I mean, a 94, 95 is close enough to being 100. So if you're going to count that as 100, the only genuine scores below 100 have been 76 and 63. Every other score has been at least 100. So it's that high floor that I really like, and that security that really, really appeals compared to Brayshaw, who I'll show in a moment as to why he doesn't in comparison. But yeah, I guess the one thing that's lacking with Neil compared to, you know, the Neil that we know and love of seasons past is the fact that he's really lacking that high ceiling score. And as you can see there, he's only really had that ceiling score of, you know, 120 plus one, two, three, four times, across the 11 games that he's played thus far. So, I mean, comparing it to last year, and he would have hit that mark a lot more, frequently. So, you know, and he's had really big scores as well, compared to this season. So, that's, I guess, the one thing in his game that's missing this year. But again, it's that high floor that, that I really value. And then of course, in recent times, at least he's scored 120 plus in what's that four of the, oh no, one, two, three of the past five games at least. So at least his form is turning around. And you can see it even up here when we look at his three-round average compared to his average overall. That's a bit of an indication of his recent form line compared to his overall average and form line. So that does appeal. Again, I'll compare it just quickly with those of you who... I love my husband. I don't know why these chicks... There. Doesn't really appeal to me. I'm not looking to buy that. Funny ad targeting there. But Brayshaw, just comparing the pair. So he's gone under 100. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6 times out of his 11 games. So again, as a previous owner last year in 2022... I rode those waves and those bumps, and I know he's got a really high variation in his scoring, which I don't like, especially with my head-to-head cash leagues that I'm in, and they're going to hurt me more than most. Above all else, I guess he's still scoring well enough over 100, but again, I'll probably see him closer to that sort of top 10 averaging midfielders, not really towards that top 8 averaging midfielder that I see Neil as. So he appeals to me less. Sarong, I don't mind as another option as well, but again, he's the higher price point. I think he's priced at around about 610 or thereabouts, 610 compared to Neil. So what's that, 33K more expensive than Neil. So Neil really does have that value factor going for him. So for those of you in a similar boat to me, looking to bring in a primo or keeper that is coming off their buy in, say, a Neil or a Sarong, I would be going between those two guys above a Brayshaw. But Neil ranks as my number one spot just purely based on value. Second up is Sarong, and then Brayshaw is third if you want to go for a midfielder. But at this stage, I'd probably wait for a Walsh. As I mentioned, coming out of his round 15 buy, he's going to be around about 500K. Super, super value. So I'd opt for, even then, Walsh above Brayshaw. So yeah, that's pretty much my insights into those guys there. And the main reason I'm going for Neil as well is because of the fact that he's obviously already had his bye, and it does mean that he's available for this coming week for round 13, 14, and 15. So for the remainder of the 3 bye weeks, he's going to be super, super valuable in terms of that. Outside of that, in terms of what I am looking to do, you would have seen last week in my team talk video, I'd written down some plans here. So this is obviously beneficial to do, and do highly recommend those of you watching to do this as well. Just to, I mean, you can formulate a bit of a plan across the remainder of the bye weeks in terms of who you're hoping to trade out and who you're hoping to bring in. And these are all guesstimations here, and this is what I'd written up last week. And you'll see here, I mean, that's kind of the trades that I did. These are the trades that I'm doing this week, so that's obviously going to plan. But outside of that, I had to guesstimate as to what, say, Weddle would be priced at. And as you can see here, he's actually smashed already that projection of what I had him priced at, because he scored that 90 on the weekend. It means that when I cash him in, he's going to be actually worth more than what I thought he would be originally. So there's going to be some bonus cash there. And I'm actually going to even reconsider maybe moving him on, because he does have that over the next couple of weeks. You'll see here in terms of projections, going into his bye week, he's projected to make 17.7K, but then coming out of the bye week for round 15, he's going to make another 19.8K if he can score a 77 across the next couple of weeks, or at least next couple of rounds that he's playing. So I am reconsidering trading him, and I may even trade someone else like a Mitchell instead, who again has a little bit of money to make, but he's going to be at a similar price point projection wise that I had Weddle at. So I could opt to trade Weddle, who's going to be giving me a little bit more cash, or maybe I'll ride Weddle for an extra week, get an extra 20K out of it. Means that I have him for that round 15 week, or that round 15 buy, as I would with Mitchell, who was my original keep. So I have something to keep in mind and really weigh up there. In terms of, I guess, trade-in options, Mullen is still my trade-in option. He looked, by all reports, okay on the weekend. He is a bottom-priced option. He's obviously has the buy this week. The benefit there is that I get to see whether or not he's selected coming out of Geelong's bye week heading into round 14. But again, that cash is going to be beneficial in able to afford Clary, the pink sweaty pig. The other sort of guesstimation that, again, has to be elevated is the price point of Briggs, who already has made us that that nice 86K first up. And my projection, which I wanted to trade him in round 15 on his buy, I had, what was it, 393, and he's projected to max out, you know, I guess secondary max out according to SuperCoach Plus there, but he's actually projected to be higher priced. What's that? 434, 393. I had him originally. So that's an extra 40K at least above what I projected him to be priced at that point when I want to trade him to Clary. So it means that I don't have to be as frugal or penny pinch budget wise in order to afford Oliver. It was going to be very, very slim, I guess, in terms of whether or not I could afford Clary, but it means now I can afford him quite easily, provided that Briggsy can keep going on his scoreline and average around about 90-odd over the next couple of weeks. So aside from that, I'm still on plan with that. It's just going to mean that I'm going to have a little bit more cash in the bank, which is going to be nice for my remaining last upgrade outside of Oliver. So it's going to give me an extra 40K. And then obviously with Ford as well, I'm looking to move him on his buy in round 15 and potentially trade him down to Marek, who was West Coast's number one mid-season rookie draftee. And he could even play as soon as this week potentially because, again, West Coast have had even more injuries. The poor mob there, they're absolutely battling. It's very reminiscent of 2022 where they were battling with injury issues and COVID issues as well. So they've been hit hard, the poor folk there. At least they've got an excuse with our injuries and the like compared to my mob and Carlton, who are just flat out shit. So West Coast supporters, hold your head high. Don't worry. At least you're not performing as bad as my mob outright just through form. But yeah, that's kind of my game plan heading into the next few weeks. I'm still on track. Knock on wood. Things continue. Guys don't get dropped. Hopefully Mullen can keep his spot. But yeah, I'm on track to bring Oliver back in round 15, coming out of his bye in round 14. So that's pretty much how my team looks at the moment, heading into the second bye week. I'll give you a bit of a quick snapshot in terms of the way things are shaping up for round 14 and 15, which will be the two bye weeks, which I am dreading majorly, which I imagine a lot of people will be in the same boat as well. But this will change, of course, with movements, as I've written down there, with the inclusions of Mullen, maybe another rookie, potentially. I could go early on trading out maybe a Ford or someone else that is not playing that week. Actually, Ford will be playing that week, so it would have to be another player that isn't playing that week to bring in, say, a Merrick. But yeah, just for this round 14, at the moment as it stands before trades for that week, I'll have 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 9, 10. I won't count sharp. 11, 12, 13, 14, 15, 16, 17, 18. So I'll have 18 at the moment at least. So at least that's a positive. But then in terms of round 15, I will have, and this is a little bit more dire, 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 9, 10, 11, 12, 13, 14 as it stands. But I will be bringing in Oliver. So that'll be, what did I have? 3, 6, 7, 8, 9, 10, 11, 12, 13. So yeah, 14. So I'll have 15 with Clary coming into the side. And then another rookie in Marek, potentially, who I don't think West Coast have the bye, do they? Let me just double check. Because if they don't have the bye in round 15, he would definitely be valuable. No, he doesn't have the bye. Okay, so that'll give me 16 plays potentially. Hopefully he's playing that week. So that'll give me 16. And then Mullen will be playing as well, hopefully. So that'll give me 17. But it might be cancelled out because Weddle already plays that week. So I might have to do another switch up. But I'm fully prepared to at least eat a couple of donuts there. As you'll see, for round 15, I've already projected myself to be having around about 15 to 16 players. So if I do end up having to eat a couple of donuts that week, so be it. All I'm hoping for is at least to have a side that has Oliver coming into the side. And it means that I'm left with at least one upgrade to go. I maybe even be able to bring in that extra player for round 15, that extra upgrade, depending on who it is, because I do have an extra 40K in the bank as well. But I'm not a big fan of sideways trading primos across the buy period in order just to cover yourself for one buy week. As I've said all along, look at the buy period as a, you know, 4 week period. Don't look at each buy week in isolation. If you do have to eat a donut or two for a given week, so be it. It is what it is, because you don't want to be eating into your reserve injury trades, which is what you'll pretty much be doing if you're not upgrading your team. Because if you're not upgrading your team, if you're not upgrading a rookie to a genuine keeper or primo, it means you're virtually sideways trading. So I'm not a big fan of that. Likewise, I guess for the discussion point that I know some of you may ask me in the comment section below as to whether or not it's worthwhile getting rid of a Sheasel or a Jay-Z. And I will say to that, tune into our weekly podcast, because Liam and I will discuss that in greater depth. But for my situation at the moment, because I've only got 8 trades to go, I know some people are saying that, oh, I'm going to get rid of Jay-Z first and foremost, ahead of, you know, trading out a rookie in order to upgrade your team and bring in a keeper off the back of a rookie and keeping Zeeble. I would say in that situation still, even if you had more than 8 trades that like I do, I would still stick to the plan of upgrading your team and getting rookies off field, because first and foremost, that is kind of what we're here to do week in, week out. If you are sort of sideways trading, and I will call it a sideways trade of, say, a Zeeble to like you say, a Sinclair or someone else, sure, it may give you some extra points if Zeeble's average downturn does continue, but it means that you're still having to stick with a rookie on field if you're doing that. So I think I'd back in Zeeble to be able to produce a higher score than, say, a rookie who you would be able to get off field for a genuine keeper. I mean, depending on who the rookie is that you have left on field, but, you know, say if you're having to field, say, a Matt Johnson, for example, and you had him on field and you wanted to trade out Jay-Z, I think I'd back in Jay-Z to score or outscore Matt Johnson compared to, you know, sideways trading Jay-Z for another keeper. So that's pretty much my thoughts on that. Again, I am looking to maybe do a sideways trade for Zeeble later in the year, but at this stage, I don't want to do that sideways trade to compromise, or what's the word, to, I guess, yeah, it kind of compromises my team. If you're doing a bit of a sideways trade for Jay-Z, who, again, I see as a bit of a luxury upgrade, ahead of, say, getting rookies off field, that's going to eat into valuable trades that you do need to use to get rookies off field. So first and foremost, get rookies off field, end of the day. And then if you need to get someone off field like a Jay-Z or a Sheasel, who are luxury sideways trades or upgrades, do that after the fact, I think. That's pretty much my thoughts on it. And that's the way that I'm treating both of those guys at the moment. I still see Sheasel and both Jay-Z as a bit of a keeper. And I probably need to be forced into that mindset anyway, because I've only got 8 trades. But after I upgrade my team fully, so once I bring in Clary, and then I bring in another keeper who could potentially be a Mills at this stage, who could be a bit of a cut price option once he returns and drops in price, then and only then I'll be thinking about doing luxury sideways trades of Jay-Z and She's Nuts. So yeah, that's pretty much how I'm looking at the moment. As you can see there, as I flashed up on screen, those are my plans. Again, I'm still sticking to those plans across the remainder of the buy period. And hopefully, knock on wood, everything goes to plan. Okay, so let's finish it off with my VC and C options. For my own team, Let me just get rid of the buys flashing up there. So for my own team, it's a bit of a tougher week compared to last week because there's quite a few more options as VC and C options. Again, we'll mention check into our weekly podcast and vodcast because Liam and I will go into greater detail across the, I guess, players that aren't in our teams across the competition wide. As I mentioned in last week's episode, the podcast and vodcast, Petrarca was my top option and he paid off if you were an owner and backed that in because he ended up scoring, I think it was 159, I think. He was the highest, second highest score for the round overall. So hopefully some of you backed in my call there if you were an owner of Petrarca. So look out for that in this week's episode. We will be we'll be picking our highest scoring captaincy options in our little head-to-head captaincy picks. For my team, I'm sort of in a few minds here. I'm thinking in terms of matchup-wise, it really does look like a good week for Laird and Dawson. So they're right up there. They play middle of the round, so could potentially be a VC option depending on if you have a captaincy option later in the round, or could be a captaincy option if you go for a VC option earlier in the round. So I'm thinking earlier in the round, potentially backing in English against Port, who, let me just go across here. So this is DFS Australia, of course. Port Adelaide have been bleeding the, they've actually cleaned up their act. Actually, that was the past five. But across the course of the season, they've actually been giving up a fair few points to opposition rucks. What's that? One, two, three. The fourth most points to opposition rucks. I know Lysett was subbed on the weekend. I don't know if he was I can't recall if it was due to injury or if it was just a tactical sub because they were absolutely pummeling the Hawks and they wanted to give him a bit of a rest because he had come back from a bit of time in the VFL and through a lack of fitness. But I do think he is someone that you could back in as a VC option at the second match of the round. Bont, I'm a little bit less bullish on because he copped a little bit of a niggle on the weekend. Don't know if he will be at full fitness, but he, again, still presents as an option. For Brizzy, who faced the Hawks, and going back to the defense V position, matchup exploitation, the Hawks, they give up the second most points to opposition midfielders. So automatically Dunks and Neil present as genuine VC options. And then, as I said, the Crows up against the Eagles. I do like the look of Dawson and Laird. Beyond that, in terms of guys in my team, Taranto up against Frio, yes, potentially. He's had a nice run of form, but again, his ceiling is really capped because of the fact that his disposal efficiency is just putrid at times and does put a bit of a cap on his scoring ability. So I probably won't go for him. In AFL Fantasy, absolutely, I'd be looking at that. That's pretty much it. I'm not a massive fan of Merritt up against Carlton. You could maybe back it in. And then probably Dacos against the Ds. Not a massive fan of that either, even though I think he scored well in his last game against the Ds. Yeah, 129 and 112. But yeah, I don't think I would be opting for him. So those are pretty much my VC and C options. I'll have to have a look a little bit further. So yeah, tune into our podcast this week or vodcast if you want to have a watch of us through the vodcast on YouTube, where Liam and I will delve into it in a little bit more depth. And again, yeah, you could potentially go for like Marshall there, SuperCoach Plus have projected him for a 148 up against, who's he up against? Hickey? Is it Hickey for the Swans? He's played for like a million teams. I think it is Hickey, yeah. Hickey and McAndrew potentially, if it's a double team sort of action against Marshall. But yeah, I wouldn't be going for Marshall. I don't think I'll look elsewhere. I think for the time being, I will lock in the VC on English, back him in, my new recruit, second week up. And then I might, ooh, it's hard. So if I go for English as a VC, I think I'll probably go for, I might go for a Dawson maybe, because I know he scores well when he's playing the home game at Adelaide Oval, which he will be doing this time around up against the Eagles. Hasn't had really a big form line up against the Eagles traditionally, but if you look at his form line at Adelaide Oval, that's where he's been doing a bulk of his scoring: 110, 114, 173, 152, 150, 89 is a bit of a off game, but a 120 and then a 106. So I'm tempted to back him in. I mean, West Coast, again, looking at exploitation in terms of matchup-wise, they give up the most points to inside midfielders. So you could probably back in either him or Laird for that given game. So I'll have to sort of flip a coin, I think, there. Otherwise, if I don't go for English as a VC, I would be happy to lock in either a Dunks or a Neil as a VC. And then again, I would be looking to go for either a Dawson or a Laird as the C. That is pretty much that. Outside of that, I think I've covered everything off. I won't progress on here on out because I'll end up waffling on. Already taken up 40 minutes of your time. So thanks again for tuning in. As always, if you have any comments, questions, whether it be with regards to your own team, which can be a little bit harder to answer, because again, I don't know how your buys are structuring up and I don't know how many trades you have left to go. And I don't know how many, primos that you have or rookies on field that you need to upgrade. So all that sort of stuff needs to be factored in for me to give you an accurate answer for a question that's specific to your own team. But if it's a question that is more generic that could apply across other teams as well, that's probably easier to answer. So feel free to drop them in the comment section below and always happy to get back to you when I can. But if it is a question that has been sent in late and during rounds, which I have seen happen as well, I'm not one to really look at the YouTube comments in round. So if you have any comments or questions, be sure to list them below over the next couple of days before the round kicks off. And I will be looking back at those and always happy to answer and help you where I can. But that's pretty much it for my team heading in to round 13, the second bye week. I'm down to two rookies on field, and Clary, I am hopeful that he doesn't go absolute bananas because I think he is returning this round in round 13, the King's Birthday Clash, before he has a much needed rest again, even though he's already had a couple of weeks rest when he goes into his bye for round 14. And then I'm licking my chops. I can smell once again the bacon wafting through the air. So I'm licking my lips to get him back into my side, but hopefully it doesn't go too bananas. But yeah, for those of you who do own him, you're probably going to ask me if he's a captaincy or VC. I'd have to be a captaincy option because he's playing the last game of the round, of course, the King's Birthday Clash. I would be wary about putting the captaincy on him first up because the D's might manage him for minutes in game just to sort of ease him back in after that hamstring injury. But yeah, you'd be brave to put the C on him, but it is the pink sweaty pig after all. So he does have a nice historical average against the Pies in those games from memory. But that's pretty much it. As I said, be sure to tune in to our weekly podcast, which will be dropping after this team talk episode drops. And of course, as I always say, if you enjoy our content, all you need to do by repaying us, you don't have to give us money. Just if you can give us a subscribe, we will be very, very appreciative of that. So thank you in advance. But as I say, until next time, we'll catch you same place, same time. We'll see you next week. And all the best for the second bye week. Thanks again, guys and girls. All the best.